Imagine a tailless aircraft soaring through the atmosphere, not with wings, but with its very shape generating lift. This wasn't science fiction, but the reality of the lifting body program, a crucial stepping stone to the space shuttle. Aerodynamic lift, essential to flight in the atmosphere, was obtained from the shape of the vehicles rather than from wings as on a normal aircraft. The addition of fins and control surfaces allowed the pilots to stabilize and control the vehicles and regulate their flight paths, taking flight with a bathtub. In the early 1960s, NASA Ames researchers Eggers and Allen were looking for ways to improve reentry vehicles. They discovered that a modified blunt-nosed cone could generate lift, allowing a controlled landing instead of a ballistic plunge. This led to the M2F1, a lightweight, unpowered prototype nicknamed the Flying Bathtub. It featured a plywood shell placed over a tubular steel frame crafted at the center. Construction was completed in 1963. The first flight test saw the M2F1 towed aloft by a hopped-up Pontiac convertible, driven at speeds up to 120 miles per hour across Rogers Dry Lake. These initial tests produced enough flight data about the M2F1 to proceed with flights behind a NASA R4D tow plane at greater altitudes. The R4D, the Navy designation of the C-47 or Civil DC-3, towed the craft to an altitude of 12,000 feet, where it was released to fly freely back to Rogers Dry Lake. NASA research pilot Milt Thompson flew the M2F1 during the first series of tests. Typical glide flights with the M2F1 lasted several minutes at speeds of 110 to 120 miles per hour. More than 400 ground tows and 77 aircraft tow flights were carried out with the M2F1 before it was retired. Tow tested behind cars and then airplanes, the M2F1 proved the lifting body concept. Its success paved the way for more ambitious designs. The M refers to manned and F refers to flight. HL comes from horizontal landing, and 10 is for the 10th lifting body design that was investigated by Langley. Enter the heavyweight spare. Next came the heavyweight lifting bodies, M2F2, HL-10, X24A, and X24B. The basic flight profile of the heavyweight lifting bodies involved being air-launched by NASA's modified NB-52B mothership at an altitude of about 45,000 feet. The XLR-11 rocket engine was then ignited, and the vehicle accelerated to speeds of up to 1,100 miles per hour and to altitudes of 60,000 to 70,000 feet. After the rocket engine was shut down, the pilots began steep glides toward the Edwards runway. As the pilots entered the final approach leg, they increased their rate of descent to build up speed and use this energy to perform a flare-out maneuver and slow their landing speed to about 200 miles per hour. The same basic approach pattern and landing speed of today's space shuttles. The first flight of the M2F2, which looked much like the M2F1. By then, the same B-52 used to air launch the famed X-15 rocket research aircraft had been modified to also carry the lifting bodies into the air. The M2F2 was dropped from the B-52's wing pylon mount at an altitude of 45,000 feet on that maiden glide flight. The M2F2 weighed 4,620 pounds without ballast, was roughly 22 feet long, and had a width of about 10 feet. The M2F2, the first heavyweight, suffered a landing accident that highlighted control challenges. The M2F3 addressed this by adding a third fin, improving stability and reaching record speeds and altitudes. The HL-10, built for NASA, flew even faster and higher than the M2F2. It also achieved the first supersonic lifting body flight, solidifying the wingless re-entry concept. The Air Force's X-24A and X-24B took a different approach. The X-24A's bulbous design validated unpowered landings, while the X-24B, nicknamed the Flying Flatiron, was a modified version focused on even higher lift-to-drag ratios. Notably, X-24B achieved the first precise landings on a concrete runway, a critical milestone for the space shuttle program. The Air Force's X-24A and X-24B took a different approach. The X-24A was a bulbous-shaped aircraft with three vertical fins at the rear for directional control. It weighed 6,270 pounds without propellants, was just more than 24 feet long, and had a width nearly 4 feet. The first unpowered glide flight of the X-24A occurred in 1969. The X-24A was flown 28 times in a program that, like that of the HL-10, helped validate the concept that a wingless vehicle could be land unpowered. Some three decades later, X-38 program managers elected to use the X-24A design to save money, since the existing X-24A aerodynamic database was complete. This limited the number of wind tunnel tests that would have been required for a totally new design. Fastest speed recorded by the X-24A was 1,036 miles per hour, Mach 1.6, and the maximum altitude reached by the craft was 71,400 feet. The X-24B's design evolved from a family of potential re-entry shapes proposed by the Air Force Flight Dynamics Laboratory, each with higher lift-to-drag ratios. To reduce the costs of constructing a research vehicle, the Air Force returned the X-24A to Martin for modifications that converted its bulbous shape into one resembling a flying flatteron, a rounded top, flat bottom, and a double delta planform that ended in a pointed nose. The X-24B, a glide flight in 1973. Among the final flights with the X-24B were two precise landings on the main concrete runway at Edwards, which showed that accurate unpowered re-entry vehicle landings were operationally feasible. The final powered flight with the X-24B was on September 23, 1975. It was also the last rocket-powered lifting body flight flown at the Flight Research Center. Top speed reached by the X-24B was 1,064 miles per hour, Mach 1.75. The highest altitude reached was 74,100 feet. The X-24B is now on public display at the Air Force Museum at Wright-Patterson Air Force Base, Ohio.